Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Well, hey, listen, I'm going to get down on my knees in just a moment. I'm going to go before the Lord in prayer, but just as a quick reminder, remember, we don't come to the Rock to hear from a man, to hear from a woman, the old or the young, the black, the white, the brown, or anything like that. We come to hear from God and from the Holy Spirit. So I'm going to get down on my knees, and I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit to be our teacher, be our counselor today. As I get down on my knees, if you're able to stand, would you join me? And let's go before the Lord in prayer today, and let's prepare our hearts to hear the Word of God this evening. So, Father, we come before you, Lord, and we're just so grateful that we have the blessed opportunity to be here. Lord, as we've seen in the news media and all around the world lately, there are so many persecutions of the church going on that, Lord, we are so blessed to be here on this night in this air-conditioned room, free of worry and without fear of persecution, to hear your word and to worship you in spirit and truth. And so, Father, today we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for blessing us, your church. And, Lord, we don't come into this place to take it for granted by listening to a man or to a woman or by hearing from a person that we like. Lord, we don't come to church for tradition or for ritual. Lord, we come into this place to hear from you. And we fully acknowledge that it's your son, Jesus, that's the senior leader of this church. So Lord, it's in the name of Jesus we ask your Holy Spirit would be our teacher today, would be our counselor, would be our guidance. As we get into the Word of God, Lord, I pray that it would just pop off the pages of the Bible, Lord, that it would come alive to us, Lord, that it would be like a seed planted into good ground, our hearts and our lives, Lord, that it would be fertile as we walk out of this place, Lord, that we would be equipped to do the work of the ministry, the full-time ministry for your kingdom in our workplaces, in our families, in our homes, wherever it might be, Lord. And we thank you for all that you've given to us and all that you've blessed us with. Lord, at no time do we think of ourselves as better or higher than anybody else, but rather we are co-laborers in the body of Christ and all working together to build your kingdom for your glory. So, Father, on this Wednesday night, Lord, we thank you for all the churches around the Inland Empire especially that are having a weekday service. It may not be tonight, it may be tomorrow, or it might have been yesterday, but Lord, we thank you for all of our brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, we ask that you would bless them as you have blessed us. Set your hand upon them, Lord. And we thank you for Harvest and the Grove and Sandals and the Well and the Way Ecclesia, Lord. We thank you for Emmanuel Baptist and New Creation and Abundant Living and all the churches across the area, Lord. We thank you that we are all brothers and sisters in the body of Christ working together to build your kingdom for your glory. So, Father, we pray that your kingdom come. Lord, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And Lord, to you be the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said,
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Well, if you've got your Bibles, I'd like for you to turn with me to the book of 1 Kings. 1 Kings in the 15th chapter. 1 Kings in the 15th chapter. I want to turn there. I'm going to give you a little bit of a summary, and then I'm going to talk to you about what we're going to talk about tonight. I'm excited for what God's got in store. It's a very important message. I think it's a real important for us as the church to grab a hold of what we're going to talk about tonight. I want to talk about the title of the message is How Compromise Can Ruin Your Life. How compromise can ruin your life. And today what I simply want to do is we're going to look at an example. There are so many examples in the Bible, and we're going to see an amazing verse towards the end of the message that really ties this together as to why we're looking at Old Testament examples. But there are really so many examples in the Bible, Old and New Testament, of people that have gone throughout their days, old and young. This is not an age-specific, not a gender-specific thing. Oftentimes we think, well, the subject of compromise is a young man's subject, or it's a man's subject, not a woman's subject. But the reality is that compromise does not discriminate, whether it's those who have lived long or those who have not lived long at all. Those who are men or those who are women, it does not discriminate, and compromise is something that we all have to understand and to deal with and to have a grasp of in our lives so that we don't suffer shipwreck in our faith. Today I want to talk about compromise, and as a way of compromise, looking at that, oftentimes we look at compromise and we see that as a valor or a characteristic that is shined in a positive outlook. As defined in the dictionary, compromise is an agreement or a settlement of a dispute that is reached by each side making concessions. So what it is basically it's two sides meeting in the middle ground. And oftentimes we see that as a characteristic or something of valor. That's a good thing to have. But also compromise goes further in its definition. It's a middle state between conflicting opinions or actions reached by mutual concession or modification. So it takes another step, or then it goes on and it says, or the acceptance of standards that are lower than is desirable. So compromise is something that each and every one of us deals with in life. Listen, sometimes in our life, compromise is good. Sometimes in our life, compromise is necessary. If you're married, you know what I'm talking about. Sometimes you just have to compromise as to what to watch on TV. Otherwise, you watch action flicks all day long, right? Baby, am I right? She's looking at me with a big old grin because she's like, you hypocrite. You don't ever compromise on the TV. She's shaking her head. Listen, I watch the chick flicks whenever she says, I like that movie. Anyways, she's calling me out. All right, forget this. I'll give you a good one that works. And sometimes in life, we've got to compromise on food that we eat. She can't argue with that one. I never ate bean and cheese burritos until I married my wife, even though she has blonde hair and blue eyes and as white gets. She is as Mexican as can be when it comes to food. Literally, three meals a day, bean and cheese burritos. Breakfast at Rosie's, lunch at Rosa Maria's, dinner at Kuka's. That is what her ideal dinner, daily diet would be. So I have learned I have to compromise and give up Top Ramen. I like Top Ramen. She don't eat it. Sometimes compromise is necessary. Sometimes we have to go through that. You know, I really like this statement. One of my interns in our young adult service, they had noticed that when you lose weight, you have to buy clothes because nothing fits anymore. So they said, hey, Pastor Luke, you're looking pretty good. And I gave him a statement that I really like. So I thought, it's really fitting for this statement. And it's a quote from Thomas Jefferson. And Thomas Jefferson says, in matters of style, swim with the current. In matters of principle, stand like a rock. You see, compromise is something that we deal with all day long. It's something that we go through. Sometimes it's good in our lives, but there are areas in our life where we cannot afford to compromise. There are things in our life that we cannot meet in the middle ground. As much as we would like to avoid the conflict, as much as we would like to avoid what would come our way because we don't meet in the middle ground, there are certain areas in our lives, specifically speaking to the subject of our Christianity and our relationship with God, that there are things, let me just say it like this, there is stuff we cannot put up with in our lives. Because if we allow compromise in our lives, it will eventually lead to ruin. Today I want to take a look at a king in the Bible. Now I used this king a couple of years ago. I went back and I did a series every once in a while on lessons from kings. And this is a really neat story out of the Bible. The king's name is Asa, A-S-A. Really cool name. And King Asa was a really neat king. And there's some things today I want to look at his life. I want to look at what the Bible tells about this man as a man who is known as a reformer of Judah or the kingdom of Judah, who brought reformation, who brought the worship back to God, but throughout the course of his life opened the door to compromise. And there were some things that happened and some prices that he paid because of those decisions. So we're going to look at that, and we're going to look at how compromise can ruin our lives. So looking at Asa, let me just give you a little bit about that. His father relied heavily on God. He was the king of Judah, and Israel was going through a civil war. This is a couple generations after King Solomon's son split the kingdom that you and I know of Israel into two halves, kind of like the northern and the southern, but you have the kingdom of Israel and the kingdom of Judah. And so here Asa's father is going into battle against Israel. Asa's father is the king of Judah, and Israel outnumbers Judah 2-1. And so Asa's father gets up on a rock and he says, listen, is it not your king? Is it not your leader that split this nation in half? And as he's making the speech, Israel flanks their military and they're surrounded. And Asa's father cries out to God, God, save us. God, as we worship you, redeem us, reveal your power to us. And God strikes the Israelites, the kingdom of Israel, and they flee. And so Asa's father relies on God. So Asa grows up. His father only reigned for 3 years, but Asa grows up seeing that relying on God, trusting in God is the way that we ought to live our life. So as he becomes king of Judah, there's peace in the kingdom for 10 years. In this period, he begins to make reformations. He tears down the idols. He removes the positions of idol worship in the kingdom. He even removes his own grandmother from the position of being the queen of Judah because she was an idol worshiper. She made a pole that was a shrine to a certain god, and the Bible says that he took that and he burnt it and he laid it down. And so he was a man of reformation. Well, it comes time that after this time of peace, the king of Ethiopia comes against Judah, and he comes to make war against King Asa, and he brings an army. Now get this, imagine this number. He brings an army of 1 million infantry, 1 million men with swords and spears to fight against the men of Israel. And he also brings along with him 300 chariots. This is a huge army. So as the men of Judah prepare to fight the king of Ethiopia, this army of 1 million, they realize that they are drastically outnumbered. So again, Asa does what his father does, and he cries out to God, and God shows his power, God shows his might, and he strikes the Ethiopian army of 1 million, and they begin to flee. And the Bible tells us that the armies of Judah ran after them. They sought after them. They slaughtered them. They conquered the lands that they ran through, and they had great spoil, and it added to the kingdom of God. And so God showed his presence because Asa was faithful to God. Now, as Asa begins to grow in his kingdom and as he begins to mature in his life, there's a period of peace, and all of a sudden the kingdom of Israel comes again to make war. And they build a garrison, or they build a fortress right on the border of Judah on the coast. So imagine if Mexico and the United States were to be at war, it would be like Mexico building a military base right in Tijuana or something, right there on the border, you know, saying, listen, we're gonna make this our infiltration point. So Asa grows in his intimidation, and he does something. He allies himself with the king of Syria. Now, this is a logical decision. Anybody who has military intellect understands that allies are something that are very important when it comes to battle. So Asa gets on, and he contacts the king of Syria and says, listen, man, here's a bunch of money. Here's a bunch of goods. You fight with me. And so they go and they plunder Israel and they destroy this fortress, and Israel backs off. But something in that happened to Asa. Something changed when that happened. So today we're going to look at this compromise in Asa. Now you can read the whole story. It's worth reading in maybe one of your devotionals. You can read the story of Asa in 1 Kings, the 15th chapter, where I have you. It's very brief. Or you can get the more laid out version in 2 Chronicles, the 14th chapter through the 16th chapter. So today I want to talk to you about the dangers of compromise. We're going to look at the dangers of compromise, looking at King Asa and the story here of his life and some of the things that have gone on throughout his life, and to understand how this applies to you and I and what this means to you and I. And I'm going to also tell you another story of something as soon as we get into this of my own, and I'll give you another illustration. So tonight I want to look at the dangers of compromise, and we're just going to give you three simple thoughts on the dangers of compromise. Tonight, the dangers of compromise is it begins small. Compromise begins small. You know, very rarely does it ever happen like in the movies when some obscure rich person with obscene amounts of money comes and says, listen, I'll give you a decision to do this or to do that, and I'll pay you millions of dollars to do this decision just out of the goodness of my heart or because I'm bored and I would like to see this happen. That does not happen. Compromise, more often than not, begins small. It begins with a thought. It begins with a seed. It begins with just a little idea. And as you begin to entertain that idea, as we begin to think upon that thought, then it grows and it becomes something. A couple of years ago, my wife and I, when we moved into our house, we have this hill in the background. And whenever you have a hill in a subdevelopment, it has to have plants on it because when it rains, the mud or the dirt on the hill washes into the yard. So it's called drainage control. And well, I moved into a repo house, so there was nothing in the backyard. Everything was dead. So we decided, let's do this on the cheap. We were up in the mountains and we saw how all these wild flowers were growing. We thought, man, that is beautiful. You know, before the fad to get into the drought tolerant and the drought resistant plants, we said, let's get into the water, because we were cheap. We didn't want to water them. So we went to the store and we bought a California wildflower seed mix. And we just went out there, we raked up the dirt and just tossed all the seeds out there, got the dirt wet, you know. And all of a sudden we began to see these really poppies and lilies and all these beautiful flowers. It was really cool. It worked out really good for a minute. What we didn't realize is that half of California native flowers are what you would consider normally to be weeds. So what happens is, we're talking about the dangers of compromise, is it begins small. We plant this and we look at it, and so they grow, and then about a week later all the flowers die. And so we say, what are we going to do? So we plant something that's a little bit more resilient, that lasts a little bit longer. So we plant the drainage control that was there in the yard or that our neighbors had. And looks great. And then all of a sudden, the next year, we see a flower. Cool. Well, that's neat. That's cool. My neighbors had this little white flower. That's neat. We saw one little flower. Cool. Wonderful. No big deal. Didn't think anything about it. Like compromise, like that weed, it begins small. You look at it, you see it in the grass or something like that. You say, that's not a real big deal. Nothing happens. But something happens if you don't address it. And we're going to look at that as the story progresses. Like compromise, a weed begins very small. It seems so insignificant. Compromise always begins small with a little thought. In the book of 1 Kings, I had you turn there as we were getting into the message today. 1 Kings in the 15th chapter, the brief overview of Asa's reign in Judah. The Bible tells us in 1 Kings in the 15th chapter, verse number 11 kind of gives us a description about King Asa. It says, Asa did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, verse number 11, as did his father David. And he banished the perverted persons from the land, removed all the idols that his fathers had made. He also removed Maachah, his grandmother, from being queen mother, because she had made an obscene image of Asherah, and Asa cut down her obscene image and burned it by the brook Kidron. Look at verse number 14, though. But the high places were not removed. Nevertheless, Asa's heart was loyal to the Lord all his days. So Asa was a man, he was a reformer. He says, listen, we're going to get this. We're going to start this off right. Kicks everybody out that's not serving God. Removes his own family from the position of authority because of the obscene image that she made. And he makes a statement by burning these things. But the Bible says, but the high places were not removed. You see, it was something small. It was out in the distance. It wasn't there in front of him. It was out on the countryside, or out thousands or hundreds of miles away. So kind of one of those out of sight, out of mind. Oh, I didn't realize it was there. Very small, very insignificant. Who cares? In Jerusalem, in the city, he reformed that. Those idols were removed. But in the country, in the high places, on the mountaintops, the high places were not removed. Now, the high places represent the idols that the Canaanites, before the Israelites or the Hebrews occupied the promised land, they would build altars, or they would build images on the tops of mountains or on the knolls of a hill on the high places, and they would worship their gods. And there they would worship their false gods. Sometimes they would sacrifice their children to these idols. Sometimes they would have sex with prostitutes in hopes for blessing from the god of fertility or for the gods of their grain or their land. All sorts of obscene things would go on. And so God's command to the Israelites, to the Hebrews, as they were entering in the promised land, all the way back to the book of Numbers in the conquest of Canaan, tells the Hebrews that you are to remove all of the idols, all of the high places, all of the things that the gods that the Canaanites worshipped, because they were unrighteous. God made it clear in the book of Deuteronomy to the Hebrews that they are not, they did not fulfill or did not take over that land because of their goodness, but because of the evilness or the wickedness of the people that dwelt in that land. So God tells, he instructs the Hebrews to remove the high places. This is not new news. Understand what I'm saying? This is many generations after the conquest of Canaan. This is a command of God, and God tells them, if you don't remove the high places, they will forever be a thorn in your side. And so guess what happens? The children of Israel didn't remove the high places. And so there they were. Always in the background, always coming up, always the competition for Baal or Asherah or the other gods that the idol worship would come. And so here they are, and the Bible says that Asa did not remove the high places. Now you and I, we don't face idol worship today. We don't worry about driving up to Arrowhead or to Big Bear and seeing a big statue or a golden image or something like that. So how does that apply to you and I? Now, even though we don't deal with idol worship in the physical, in our lives, there are many idol-isms, I'll say it like that, that we deal with. There are many isms in our lives that want to be idols or put above or superior to God in our life. Things like materialism. Things like rampant sexism. How about things just like me-ism or selfishness? That we look at our priorities, me, myself, I. Look at the state of humanity. All you have to do is go to a public place and how many people are looking down at themselves versus out and around. So we have all these things that begin small. They begin so insignificant. They don't seem like a big deal. But if we don't look at them and we don't address them and we don't tear them down in our lives and not give them any place, then that leads to the next step of our lives. Look what the book of James says. I'll just put it on the overhead for you. James in the first chapter, verse number 14 says, But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and is enticed. Temptation does not come from God. Compromise in your mind does not come from God. To say, well, you know, a little bit of this, a little bit of that, a little bit in, a little bit out, you know, a little bit here and there. He says, everyone is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and is enticed by entertaining that little thought. Well, it would be nice if, or, you know, she is good looking. Or nobody will know it's secret or whatever it might be. We entertain these thoughts and they begin as a seed. And look what it says in verse number 15. But when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. So you see, it's a process. Very rarely do Christians just jump off the bandwagon. Man, forget it. I'm going to go full bore. Never done it in my life, but I'm going to go to crack. I'm going to go to the prostitute. I'm going to get drunk, even though it's never happened. It doesn't work that way. It's a little thing. It's somebody says, try this. It's no big deal. You'll have a good time. Hey, man, you don't even have to participate. Just come and hang out. Whatever it might be. It starts out small, like a little weed in a garden. We've got to be aware because compromise can ruin our lives. It starts off small, entertaining that thought that we know is not the thought that God wants. That thing will become big if we give it place. We're talking about the dangers of compromise. The second thought for today is the dangers of compromise is it's commonplace. Compromise is commonplace. We're used to it. We're accustomed to it. We see it all day, every day. You see the bumper stickers on the driveway that say coexist. Love one another. Hey, listen, all right, you know, there's some similarities to Allah and to God, so why can't y'all just get along? There are things in our life that we cannot say, let's just get along to. There are things in our life that say, no, I will stand on this matter of principle like a rock, regardless of what goes on in my life. So the dangers of compromise to you and I is that it is commonplace, like a weed. Remember my garden? It started off, it looked like a flower. You know what I thought to myself the first time I saw the weeds growing in my hill after I had planted my little vines on my hill? I thought, that's a cool looking flower. I'm going to let it grow. Guess what happens when you let a weed grow? It gets bigger. Anybody ever been there before? Man, it's like, oh my goodness, the weeds just do not stop. Well, just a botany reference for you. If you've got green thumbs, don't ever throw a California wildflower mix because it will be uncontrollable. But you see, it's like the weed. It starts off green. In the season, March, in the rainy season, the weeds come up. I remember we bought our house in the wintertime. We thought we had grass in the front yard. In the summertime, we realized we were just mowing weeds. Because it starts off looking normal. It's something, it's commonplace, yeah, that looks like it belongs. But then as it grows, as it begins to metastasize or to build momentum, then all of a sudden it begins to change and you begin to see it for what it really is. And then it's a problem. Asa did what one might say is completely reasonable that any human would do. When he was faced with opposition, he called for an ally. Hey, I would have thought, why not? That's great. Maybe Syria will get saved. Anybody ever said that? Well, we're dating, or, they're my friends. They're going to get saved, though. I'm praying for that. Compromise. Listen, look at the statistics over and over and over again. Guys, this stuff doesn't work. Little tiny thoughts. So here Asa does this thing that seems completely reasonable. He calls up Syria and says, ally with me. So look what it says in 2 Chronicles. If you got your Bible, turn to the book of 2 Chronicles. You guys with me today? Are we all right? Yes, okay. Give me a little nod every once in a while. Let me know you're still awake, you're still here. 2 Chronicles in the 16th chapter, the more detailed life of Asa, talks about and chronicles his treaty with Syria. 2 Chronicles in the 7th chapter, so Asa allies himself with Syria, and Israel runs away. Success, wonderful, we did our job, that we defeated the enemy, isn't that the goal? Well, all of a sudden, God sends a prophet or a seer to Asa, and he gives him a message from the heart of God in 2 Chronicles in the 16th chapter, verse number 7. And at that time, Hanani, the seer, came to Asa, the king of Judah, and said to him, because you have relied on the king of Syria, and have not relied on the Lord your God. Man, when a prophet comes and the first thing he says is, because you relied on a man and not God, you know the rest of the message is not going to be very good. You see, Asa was a man that called out to God and saw in front of his very eyes the army of 1 million infantry scattered and run for their lives because of the power of God. Asa was a man who grew up seeing his father's battle victories because he cried out to God and God was on their side. Asa was a man loyal to God. So now all of a sudden, Asa faces an opposition that is nowhere near what happened with Ethiopia. And the first thing he does is run to man instead of God. Because, remember we said, the high places were not removed. There was a seed in his heart because there was an overlooking, a turning away, or a, I'm not going to look at that. I'm just going to pretend I didn't see that happen. Something happened in Asa's life and it began to grow. And so now all of a sudden he calls on Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, and look what it goes on. And it says, because you've relied on the king of Syria and not have relied on your Lord your God, therefore the army of the king of Syria has escaped from your hand. They are not your allies. Were the Ethiopians at the Lubin not a huge army with very many chariots and horsemen? Yet because you have relied on the Lord, he delivered them into your hand. For the eyes, look at what the prophet says. He says, for the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is loyal to him. God's desire is for somebody to be uncompromising in their faith, in their belief, in their principal belief towards him, to say, listen, even when opposition comes my way, I will go to God first and I will go to God foremost. I will do what God tells me to do. If God says to remove the high place, whether it hurts or it doesn't, I will do it. A hard statement. Jesus says, if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off. Do you think he was talking literally? No. You know that the right hand is a sign of dominance. Most people in the world are born right-handed. So if you cut off your dominant hand in an agrarian society where you work for a living with your hands, guess what happens to you? Your well-being is cut off. He goes as far as to say, if your well-being causes you to sin, stop. That's big. See, God is looking, roaming the earth. His eyes are looking to and fro for somebody that will be faithful to him, who shows themselves loyal to him. So it goes on and he says, for the eyes of the run, those who are loyal to him, if you have done this foolishly, in this you have done foolishly. Therefore, listen to this, from now on, you shall have wars. So you see, there was a period of peace in Asa's reign. There was a period of blessing. The nation of Judah was growing, and he had gotten complacent. He had gotten comfortable in his position. You know, that happens so often in our relationship with God. We do well. Things begin to go well for us. The job, we get promotions, and things are looking up. We get a bigger house, get a better job, or the kids seem like they're doing okay. We become comfortable, and we ignore these high places in our lives, these isms that God says to walk away from, to have no part of. Even though they're going on in the back of our minds, they may be a small seed. If we don't remove them, they will grow like a weed into something bigger. And it's exactly what happened with Asa in his life. Sometimes the thing that we struggle with when we compromise seems so commonplace. We even go as far as to say, it's human. We're just being human. I've said that statement before. I'm just human. What may seem logical or even rational to man may not be aligned with God's will. And we've got to understand that. Asa sought help from another king, no big deal. Look what it says in Galatians. I'm just going to put this up for your reference so we can go through in time. Galatians in the 5th chapter, verse number 19. Galatians in the 5th chapter, verse number 19, it says, now the works of the flesh are evident. Evident. Commonplace. Easily seen. You do not have to work or dig very hard to see human nature. Anybody know what I'm talking about? It's not difficult to see somebody's true nature revealed. Right? You scratch a little bit and the paint comes off. The works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, and uncleanliness, lewdness. Verse number going on. Idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contention, jealousies, outbursts, wrath, selfishness, and selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies going on, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I've told you in times past, that those who practice such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Even though it's flesh nature, even though it's evident, even though it's commonplace, even though it's easy, even though it seems natural, we cannot allow compromise to take place because it'll come in the appearance of things that are common to you and I. And we cannot do that. Just because it's common or because it seems natural doesn't mean it's right. We must begin thinking like Christians and not just like humans. We were made in the image of God. We have been given something that God has given nobody else on this earth, intellect. Think about that for a moment. They say dolphins can build cities if they had opposable thumbs. Dolphins do not, let me just share with you. I'm not a marine biologist, but I'll tell you something I know for a fact. Dolphins are not as smart as humans. You know why? Because if humans did not have opposable thumbs, we would still figure it out. You know what I'm saying? Anybody, you know, Pastor Luke, man, I can't even figure it out with thumbs. It's all right. There are some of us that can. Praise God. God has given us something that nobody else has, intellect, the ability to communicate with Him, the desire to communicate with Him. God desires us to not think like men, but to communicate with Him, to think like Him. The dangers of compromise, last one for the last thought for tonight. The dangers of compromise is it hardens the heart. Compromise serves to harden the heart. Like that weed that I planted in my garden. As it grew and we pulled it out and the other one, that the little flower that was white. Man, that's a pretty little flower. It doesn't take much water. Let's just see what happens to it. That weed grows and it grows and it grows. And you know what happens when that weed grows? The things around that weed begin to stop growing. Because that weed is sucking the water out of the ground before it gets it. It's starving it to death. It's overshadowing it. It's not getting any more sunlight. As the weed gets bigger, the plants around the weed get smaller. Compromise is just like that. As compromise begins to grow, it starts out small. It's commonplace, so we make excuses saying that it's human or it's just natural or I didn't even think of anything about it. And as it begins to grow in our life, then it begins to grow and it gets bigger and it gets bigger and it begins to starve out into the point where our hearts have become hard and we no longer are receptive to hearing the voice of God in our lives. And then we wonder, God, where are you? When God says, I've been here all along, where are you? Got to be weary of that. In 2 Chronicles, we're looking at the life of Asa. The next verse that we were at in 16th chapter, verse number 10, as he's continuing on this subject, the conversation with the seer. Verse number 10, 2 Chronicles, the 16th chapter says, Asa was angry with the seer and put him in prison. For he was enraged at him because of this. And Asa oppressed some of the people at that time. Here's a man the Bible says was loyal to God, was faithful to God. And now God sends a messenger saying, hey, fix your ways. You made a mistake. You're going to have wars, but it doesn't mean it's over. It means you're going to have hard times. Action breeds consequence. And Asa's heart is so hardened now to God that he takes it out on God's messenger and God's people. No longer hearing the words of God, no longer hearing the voice of God, and now he throws the messenger in prison and he oppresses the people because of his outrage, because of the message of God. See, conflict, compromise will harden our hearts. Skipping a couple verses down, the Bible begins to tell us the end of Asa's life. It says that he contracted a disease in his feet. Verse number 12. In the 39th year of his reign, Asa became diseased in his feet, and his malady, or his disease, his condition was severe. Look what it says. Yet in his disease, he did not seek the Lord, but physicians. Asa gave up. His heart was hardened. His heart no longer was receptive to things of God. Why? Because one compromise after the next compromise, after the next compromise, after the next compromise, after overlooking this because I don't want to deal with the conflict, after turning my head or just keeping my mouth shut because I don't want to say something and make somebody offended. One thing after the next. Look at the end of this man's life. He dies of this disease because he did not seek God, he sought after men. Here a man was delivered by God against an army of a million people, saw God's hand over a little thing like the healing of his feet, didn't even ask God for anything because his heart had grown hard. Hebrews in the third chapter tells us in verse number 13, exhort one another daily while it is called today, while you have today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. The deceitfulness of sin. Think about that statement there, the deceitfulness of sin. Deceitfulness meaning it comes and it looks small. It's no big deal. Hey, that's not a big deal. God will forgive me for that one. The deceit, and then it becomes a little bit bigger, a little bit bigger, a little bit bigger, a little bit bigger, a little bit more, a little bit more, a little more, until it's taken over in our lives and all of a sudden we are hardened in our hearts because we say that God is no longer with us. Heaven forbid. We, the church, we, the followers of God, allow compromise into our life that would take us away from our position with God. So tonight, before I leave you, I don't want to just give you with the downers of what compromise will do to you. I want to talk to you about how to deal with compromise. Can we deal with compromise tonight? All right, y'all quiet, looking at me like a cow at a new gate. Just chewing on that cud. Dealing with compromise in our lives. I'm going to give you one simple thought. There's so many things that we could talk about. There's so many points that we could have. There's so many ideas and points and clever rhyming things that spell things and give you freebies like I've done on the Sunday nights. I'm just going to give you one. Because if you remember the one, I think you can go from there. All right? One important thing that will change your life. Now, obviously, it's important to remember to look at these things. So remember that it starts small. That it looks normal, that we're used to what compromise looks like because we see it every day in our lives and that it hardens our heart. Those are very important things. But today, the one thing on how to deal with compromise, so simple. Don't focus on sin. Focus on God. So simple. Don't focus on sin. Focus on God. Think about it like this. If I was to come in to tell you as a mandate, now this is, please, this is metaphorical. This is exemplary. I do not want to see anybody on Facebook saying, Pastor Luke says that if I'm going to do this, if I'm at the Rock, I have to believe this, okay? But if I was to say, if you want to attend the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, I demand, I require that you forget elephants ever existed. They don't live. No elephants. No Asian elephants. No African elephants. Forget elephants. Forget about it. Don't even remember the word. Forget the word. Remove it from your vocabulary. You cannot remember elephants any longer. You know where half of you just went? Most of you just went? Y'all just thought about elephants. What does an elephant look like? Oh, yeah. We know that. You're chuckling because you know that. It's been a human experiment since the dawn of time. Don't think of something, I thought of it. Yes. But then when it comes to sin, we think of sin. Don't do it. Oh, I did it. Don't do it. Oh, I did it. Stop doing it. Oh, I did it again. And then we wonder, God, we're crazy. Where are you? And God's saying, stop focusing on sin. Because every time you think about it, you're going to do it. It's the same thing. Mountain biking. When I was mountain biking, when I was hiking, man, you think about don't fall, don't fall, don't fall, don't fall. Guess what happens right after you think that? You fall. And then after you pick yourself up and pull yourself out the bush, I see Brandon there. One time he picked me out of a bush. I got cuts all over my back. Guess what happened the rest of the trip? I didn't think about falling. Because I remembered, oh yeah, if I think about falling, I'm going to fall. Why? Because wherever I look is where I go. If I look at that rock and say, don't fall on that rock, guess what? I'm looking at it. I'm turning that direction. It's the same exact principle with sin. You think about sin, don't think about it. Mm-hmm. Don't think about it. Mm-hmm. Oh, I've got this temptation going on. Don't think about it. Mm-hmm. And so we wonder, what's going on? Why is this? Can I just share a crazy thought with you? We cannot stop sinning on our own. What? The Bible says we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Remember that thing about the fruits of men? They're evident, right? That's just nature. That's natural. Sin is natural in our lives. We are unable to stop sinning on our own. That's why Christianity is not a self-help message. That's why it's not about doing good for yourself. That's why it's not about trying this or read this book and everything will be good in your life. It's not about focusing on the issue. It's about focusing on God. It's about not ridding yourself of sin. It's about worshiping God. Because you know what the reality is that darkness can only exist in the absence of light. Wherever there is light, boom, instantly, darkness is gone. But if we do not have light in our lives in the sense that we do not focus on God, then guess what happens to our lives? We stay in darkness. And then we wonder, why am I sinning? Why am I messing up? Why can't I shake this? Why can't I stop this? What is going on? And we're looking at the problem, and we need to be focusing on God. If you got your Bibles, I'm going to finish on this. Go with me to the book of 1 Corinthians in the 10th chapter. 1 Corinthians in the 10th chapter. Now, you remember in the very beginning of the message, I said, I think it's good for us to look at Old Testament examples to learn from. And today we looked at an Old Testament example to learn about compromise. 1 Corinthians in the 10th chapter, beginning in verse number 6. The subheading of the 10th chapter in my Bible is Old Testament examples. Fitting. Verse number 6. Now these things became our examples, to the intent that we should not lust after things that they also lusted after. Verse number 7. And do not become idolaters as some of them. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Nor let us commit sexual immorality as some of them did. And in one day, 23,000 fell. Nor let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted and were destroyed by serpents. Nor complain, as some of them also complained and were destroyed by the destroyer. Now all of these things happened to them as examples, and they were written for our admonition, upon whom the end of the ages have come. God says, listen, you are here for a reason. I have recorded all of these examples about sexual immorality, about complaining, about compromise, about idolatry. All of these things in your life, they have been recorded as to what has happened to them so that it will not happen to you. Because he says, whom the ends of the ages have come, that means you are on God's dream team. The final moments of the game, the buzzer's going down, and it's time to send in the star players. That is for you and I, and we have been given the game plan of the Bible so that we would learn from what has gone on in the past. In verse number 12, it goes on, therefore, let whom thinks he stands take heed. Listen up, be wise, lest he fall. Because he goes on and he says, no temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But you know what? If you read a good self-help book, you'll be good in life. Is that what it says? No temptation has overtaken you that is common to man. But if you try really hard, you'll get through it. Does it say that? It says no temptation has overtaken you except as is common to man, but God is faithful. It goes on to say, who will not? Who is he speaking of now? Who? God, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, speaking of God, continue on in the next verse of that, but with the temptation also make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. Who will make a way of escape? You? Your neighbor? Dr. Phil? Oprah? God will make a way of escape. So how do we deal with compromise in our life? Stop focusing on the sin. Stop focusing on the issue. And start focusing on God, not to get rid of it. No. Because then you're focusing on it. You just don't realize it. Focus on God because God is good. Because God is able. Worship God. I promise you, it is very difficult to commit sin in the middle of worshiping God. Very rarely do we, I was thinking about, oh, God, I love you. What? Really? Man, dude, look at that girl. Oh, my goodness. Doesn't happen because we're not focusing on that. We're focusing on God who gives us a way of escape. Psalms in the 34th chapter, verse number 14 says, depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. God is peace. Jesus Christ is the Prince of Peace. I love what Pastor Jim says. I'll end on my dad's quote. What you compromise to keep, you will lose. Church, let's not be a church of compromise. Let's not be Christians of compromise that are watered down and impotent in the things of God because we have let it grow into our lives. But rather, let's stand like a rock on the matters of principle. Hey, if you lose weight, you got to buy clothes, and you think, man, I don't know about these clothes. In matters of style, swim with the current. Whatever. Dye your hair purple if it makes you happy. But in matters of principle, stand like a rock because what you compromise to keep, you will lose. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God tonight? Praise God. Listen, there's a couple things I want to do. First and foremost, it's very difficult to teach on compromise and to watch hundreds of people make small decisions to get up and leave early. I want to encourage you, those of you that hear my voice, church isn't out. Some things that you especially need to hear in this place today. And, you know, we talked about compromise ruining your life and beginning small, something, an easy decision. I've done my part. Let me make this decision. I'll get out of here before the traffic starts. Listen, come on. Let's have enough respect for God, enough self-respect in your own life to listen to the things of God because it's important for you. Stop making dumb decisions like that. I understand there are some of you that have medical conditions and some of you that can't, you know, that needed to use the restroom or whatever it might be. But for those of you that don't, you know who I'm talking to. You know where you're going through. You need to hear the sound of my voice. If you're still here, you're listening, you come back. Sit in the foyer, watch the TV, listen to the sound of my voice, because what we're about to talk about right now is very important, and you need to hear it and stop compromising your life with God. I love you enough. I respect you enough. I honor you enough to tell you the truth, to be in front. I won't run from the conflict, the awkwardness of getting in your face because you leave early every week. But I'll tell you the truth. You got some problems with you between you and God, and you need to get yourself right with God today. There are those of you in this place that are not right with God. And today I want to give you the opportunity to be right with God. It would be a travesty for us to leave today on the pretenses that everybody in this building is okay with God, when in reality, you know and I know that there are those in this place that are not right. So today I want to ask you a question. If you were to leave and you were to die, your heart were to stop beating and you died, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? It's a very simple question. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can think your way into heaven? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can hope your way into heaven? Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you want to, because you wish, because I think I can, means you're going to get into heaven? You can't get to heaven based on your well-being or your well-thinking. because you have positive outlook on life, because you're a happy person. It doesn't work that way. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because, listen, you attend church, listen to the pastor preach, because you volunteer in the children's or youth ministry, because you carry the pastor's Bible. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that you're going to get into heaven because of those things. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents told you you were a Christian, because you grew up under the pretenses that, well, I was baptized as a baby, or my parents told me I was a Christian, went to church on Christmas and on Easter. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say those things that you're going to get into heaven? You can't get to heaven because your parents told you you're a Christian. You can't get to heaven because you call yourself a Christian. Well, Pastor Luke, I'm a Christian. We say that all the time in America. I'm a Christian, but I drink. I'm a Christian, but I have sex. I'm a Christian, but I'm this. Or but it doesn't matter what you call yourself. I could call myself a Dodger. Go buy a uniform and sit in L.A. in the dugout in the Dodger Stadium. Guess what? Not a Dodger. Just because we think we're a Christian, because we call ourselves a Christian, because our parents told us we were Christians, because we want to, because we hope so, because we desire to get into heaven. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that you're going to get to heaven those ways. Well, Pastor Luke, I'm a good person. I've done more good in my life than I do bad. I give to humanitarian aid efforts. I try to help my fellow human. I don't rob the 7-Eleven or anything like that. I try to stay good. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person, you're going to get into heaven? The Bible tells us that our good deeds, according to God's righteousness, are like filthy rags. Nothing you and I could ever do would ever make us good enough to get into heaven. Why? Because God's standard for entrance into heaven is perfection. But the problem is, like I mentioned earlier, the Bible says that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, which means all of us by default have not made it or not met the requirements to get into heaven. Well, what do we do? How do we get there? Listen, you know, you can't get to heaven your way. Can't get to heaven my way or some well-meaning church committee or author's way. The only way we can get to heaven is God's way. It's God's heaven, God's way. And Jesus Christ is that way. Jesus says these words. He says that I am the way, the truth, and the life, he says, about himself. No one goes to the Father, he says, except through me. Let's not do it any other way but God's way. In John, the third chapter, Jesus was speaking to a man in the Bible by the name of Nicodemus. Nicodemus, the Bible says, was a Pharisee and a leader of the Jews. What that says to you and I is that Nicodemus was an educated man. Nicodemus was well off in the scriptures, memorized the scriptures. Nicodemus taught in the synagogue or the church of his day. Nicodemus gave to the poor. Nicodemus was a good person. And as they're discussing the subject of eternal life, you would think Jesus says to Nicodemus, man, keep on going. Great is your reward in heaven. But Jesus says to Nicodemus these words, you must be born again. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking of what Hollywood, society, pop culture has made born again out to be radical, weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity. But let me tell you something. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing in the eyes of God. Who cares what Hollywood says? They've got no concept of God. Watch Noah and you'll find out. But simply put, born again from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible has always meant the same thing. Here it is. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God. You know, the Bible tells us in the book of James that the devil in hell and the demons in hell know who Jesus is and believe. God's not after your mental assent towards him. He's not after your carnal knowledge of who he is. You say, man, I already know who Jesus is. I know about John 3:16 and all these things. No, listen, I already know you know who Jesus is. That's why you're here. God's not after your mental assent or your carnal knowledge of who he is. He's after all of your heart. He's after all of your life. Let me prove it to you. The book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible, Jesus Christ is speaking to the church. And when he speaks to the church, he says these words. He says, I'm coming back. And when I come back, he says, I better find you hot or I better find you cold. Because if I find you lukewarm, he goes on, he says, I will vomit you from my mouth. Whoa! Shocking statement. And what Jesus Christ is saying is that lukewarm Christians are not real Christians at all. And they'll be rejected and ejected, counted as waste from the kingdom of God. What does lukewarm mean? Let's define that in terms of your relationship. Lukewarm simply mean little bit in, little bit out, little bit up, little bit down. Occasional church attendance, doing your own thing, doing some of God's thing. We say it like this, you're right in the fence. Little bit of God, little bit of the world. Little bit of God, little bit of the world. Right in the middle, not happy in either one of them. Listen, if that's you in this place, I love you enough, I respect you enough, I honor you enough, and more importantly, I honor God enough to tell you the truth, that you can't get to heaven based on your own devices. You can't get to heaven based on what your parents tell you. You can't get to heaven based on your wishful thinking or based on the fact that you're a good person. Can't get to heaven based on the fact that you attend church. Can't get to heaven because you think you have a relationship. God forgive us in the American church for watering that message out for hundreds of years so that we have become deceived in thinking we're right with God when the truth is we are far off. So today, how do we get there? How do we get into heaven? How do we make sure that we spend eternity with God in heaven, leaving hell behind? Simply put, Jesus Christ, as I said, he said he's the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through him. Let's not do it any other way but God's way today. And Jesus says these words. He says, if you confess me before men, I will confess you before my Father. He says, but if you deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father. Today, in this auditorium, right now, I'm going to give you opportunity. Just a moment, I'm going to do this. I'm going to count to three. I'm going to go one, two, three. I smack my hands together real loud like that. Bang! And when I smack my hands together, here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm going to ask you to be bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. What you're doing by the raising of your hand, you're saying, hey, Pastor Luke, I want to give God my heart. Pastor Luke, today I want to get saved. I want to give Jesus my heart. I want to give him my life. I want to make sure today I'm going to get into heaven. You say, Pastor Luke, if I raise my hand, I'm going to be embarrassed. I don't think I could do that. Let me encourage you. You might feel a moment of embarrassment because somebody might see you. Wouldn't it be better to spend a moment of embarrassment than an eternity in hell because you can't go forward for God in a warm, welcome, and loving place like the church? The decision's yours. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way. And listen, let's get it straight. God's not in heaven with a 2x4 waiting to whack you over the head for everything you've done. He's not like a little kid on an anthill with a magnifying glass trying to burn you up. God loved you so much that he gave Jesus Christ to die a beaten, bloody mess, to hang naked on a cross for your and my sins. In return, he wants all of our heart. He wants all of our life. And it starts today by making that profession. Who should raise your hand if you've never given God your heart? You've never given God your life. In just a moment, if that's you, pop your hand up. Who should raise your hand if you're not sure? Maybe you did this as a child or in the youth group. Maybe you did this at a Harvest Crusade or something like that, but you never really followed through with it. Come on, if that's you in this place, don't walk out of here without making sure. Who should raise your hand if you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God saying, hey, listen to this. You've been making compromises in your life and in your Christian walk with God. If that's you in just a moment, get ready, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. I'm a man. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. We'll go forward from there. Wherever you're at in this place, from the front row to the back row, you guys in the family rooms, I'm talking to you over there, I'll see your hand. If you're outside in the foyer listening to the sound of my voice or watching on the television system, I'm talking to you as well. Get ready. This is your moment. This is your time. If you're at home online watching on your computer screen, get ready. This is your moment. I'm going to count to three in just a moment. If that's you in this place, you know who you are. The Bible says it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. It has nothing to do with the man. It has everything to do with you and God. So today, shed that moment of embarrassment. Make the best decision that you as a human being can make. Today, let's go forward in your relationship with God. This is a divine appointment right here, right now. You've had doctors and dentist appointments and DMV appointments. Now it's an appointment between you and God. Don't miss this opportunity. I'm going to count to three. Get ready. All across this auditorium, wherever you are, from the front row to the back row. I want to see your hands. Pop it up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. Here we go. Ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three. I see that. Four, five, six, seven, eight. I see that hand right there. Eight wise people. Anybody else in this place today? Nine. I see that hand back there in the family room. Anybody else in this place today? Nine wise people. I saw that hand back there, my man. Nine wise people. Anybody else in this place? Ten. I see you back there in the back row. Ten wise people. Anybody else today? I'm going to finish this up right now. That's you in this place. You say, man, I wonder if I should. You should. Come on. Stop playing games with God. Stop messing around with God. Let's get forward. Go get right with God today. Go forward in your relationship. Ten wise people. Anybody else? I see hands pointing in that direction. Ten wise people. Anybody else today? Well, hey, praise God for 10 wise people. All right, here's what we're going to do. All 10 of you who raise your hands, whether you guys are in the family rooms, the ushers will come help you grab your stuff. Front row, back row, wherever you're at. You said you want to give God your heart. You said you want to give God your life. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by making Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior. You say, I want to do this. It's the first step. Now we're going to follow through, and we're going to pray together. We're going to change destinies right here, right now. So as we do this, we're all going to stand. We're all going to sing a song together. If you raise your hand, you should have raised your hand. Grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, friend, if you need a friend. Get out of your seat. Come meet me right here. Let's change destinies together right here, right now. That's you. Come on. You can come.
You're all
that's you, come on.
I want. You're all I've ever needed.
You can come on, if that's you.
You're all I want. Help me know you.
Come on, we'll welcome you. Come on down.
You're all hey guys, I want.
Congratulations.
You're all I've ever needed. You're all.
Praise God. Well, hey guys, listen. A couple of things. First and foremost, you're not going to a funeral. Going to a birthday celebration, all right? It's time to smile. It's time to celebrate. Made a wise decision. Best decision you can make as a human being. Did you know that? Choosing eternity. I mean, how awesome is that? Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name is Pastor Joel. Like Noel, Joel, right? Really cool guy. Here's what he's going to do. He's going to take you right over there. Oh, wait. I promise. Nothing weird goes on, okay? I am as weird as it gets at this church. I promise you that one, okay? Pastor Dan is not even as weird as me, all right? I am as weird as it gets. I'll just admit it to you. You made it through me. Nothing weird goes on. He's going to take you right over there. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by asking Jesus to be your leader, the Lord and Savior of your life. So you're going to pray a prayer. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information as you go home to read. Just say, hey, what do I do now? We're going to point you in the right direction. Third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. Sit with somebody, a friend, somebody who will meet with you for a couple of weeks. They'll buy you a cup of coffee right at the church or a soda or something like that. Sit down with you, talk to you about the Word of God for a couple of minutes, teach you some things to get you strong in the ways of God so you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from and you go forward in everything that God has for you. So if you would turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me. And then he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.